Sade and Joan, thank you so much for joining today. I'm really excited about this conversation we get to have. Joan Robinson-Berry, newly retired Vice President and Chief Engineer from Boeing Global Services. Sade Rolon, our Associate Vice President of Environmental Services for our Provider Division here at ProMedica. You know, this is gonna be a really, really good conversation as we exit Black History Month and move into Women's History Month. We've got two powerful women that I'm just really excited about having some conversation with and understanding a little bit more about you, your perspectives, and also sharing that with our employees and others across the nation. So welcome to both of you.
Well, thank you so much, Greg and Sade. It's always a delight to see you.
Always a pleasure as well. And many that will be watching may not know, but we do have a distinct relationship. She is actually my aunt on my mother's side. So very excited to be having that opportunity for our paths to cross in this sense. And so glad that you could be part of this discussion on diversity, education, and inclusion. So I know that I personally have a understanding of your backstory, an amazing backstory from your humble beginnings in Los Angeles, just as a passionate girl who loved mathematics. But many of the viewers that will be reviewing this will not know who you are exactly. So could you just start with telling us more about yourself, what it was like growing up in Los Angeles, and ultimately what led to your path in becoming a vice president for Boeing Global Services?
Well, first of all, thank you for that question. That's a good one. I want to tell you, my childhood was nothing but a Hallmark card. It was tough. It was challenging. At times overwhelming. You know, I was weighted down because I'm a not so hidden figure. You know, it wasn't in vogue for women to be engineers back in the day. There was no engineering in mindset even in my school. And I was weighted down by, you know, of course, back in the day, unconscious bias, people call it racism. And then the heartache of knowing that my father was killed in the line of duty. So there was a lot of hardship in my life. And I'm not sharing that because I want people to be, have sympathy for me. But I know that there's listeners on this call that may be going through something similar, especially in this pandemic. You know, I know a lot of loss of lives, you know, we're 500,000 folks in that area. But even if you're not, I want you to know that I had this mindset and I want you to have this mindset that you should never let doubters, setbacks, challenges, you know, have power to really dim your light, to illuminate your light. And I had the honor of having, you know, being raised by wolves because I was kind of like a Lasky kid in a what we call a barrio in Los Angeles County. It was a very gang-ridden area, but my great escape was I focused on math. I had just a passion for everything about math. I have two older sisters, and I remember I memorized all my multiplications. I understood all my fractions, and I was in like first or second grade, and they were two or three grades, above me, and they put me in their math class. And I knew at that time, there was one teacher that said that math skill set is going to be your great equalizer. But I didn't really know what to do with math. So I continued to practice. I continued to have a more of a gift in that area. And it wasn't teachers because I had a lot of doubters, you know, because I was very social. They wanted me to go into kind of a social science field. But I had one girlfriend was also in my math honors program. She said, you know, there's a field called engineering. It's really exciting. You get a chance to actually improve the quality of life by making things. And it's something you should consider. I was toying between, you know, going to law school or, you know, studying engineering. And when, coming from a very humble beginning, and I would actually say hungry at sometimes when they said that they were going to pay me, you know, $20 an hour back you know, 30 years ago, I said, you know, I'll take engineering for 200, please. And so I started my journey. First job on my 18th birthday. And you have to think about back in the day, male dominant field, no women. And I got my first internship job in a big aerospace company, General Dynamics. And we showed up the first day and they said, all the men get to go on the drafting tables. By the way, they do that on computers, but the girl, she has to go to the production floor. And again, when I said, don't give obstacles power, that was a horrible decision in my mind at that time. But really, it was the best decision of my career, because I learned to design for manufacturing, and I understood exactly how to make things, where the other males went up to the drafting table, had no mindset of manufacturing, but more theoretical knowledge. And I jumped higher than they ever would. And I started an engineering company by the time I was 20, because I was, had that gift. And then I said, 18 hours a day in a company, or should I go back to corporate America? And I did. And I, you know, was blessed to have such an amazing career, because I had that entrepreneurial mindset in my headset when I went back into the industry. And I was the first African-American to ever be in charge of a major airplane program. And at that time it was McDonnell Douglas. And we decided to merge with Boeing. And I said, they were the evil empire. I want to try another part of McDonnell Douglas. So I went to space and comm. And so I was the generation that managed or was part of the engineering team that managed the space shuttle that went to the International Space Station. And can you imagine, you know, a girl from the hood hanging out with astronauts, and you're close as any human can be. And when the aircraft or the spacecraft, you know, turned on that engine and the vibration would cause the back of your hair to go up, I said, I would pay Boeing, or at that time, McDonnell Douglas, to do this job. So I've had a tremendous job. And, you know, I can go the 40 years that I was in it, but I ended up being at the top of my game, again, blessed. I'm a faith-based person. I know it was, you know, divine intervention that got me there. But I ended up being the highest ranking African-American in aerospace as a chief engineer. There's no African-American females in a major aerospace company that did that. And again, it was that my great escape was really focusing on the math side of the business, and been around the world, met all the last seven presidents. And I've had an amazing career. So that's kind of my CV and a quick nutshell.
And you have. And just to mention, I mean, three honorary doctorate degrees from Charleston State University, Allen University, and Cal Poly. Right.
I was too lazy to get my doctorate, right? So they had to give me honorary doctorate. So yeah, call me Dr. Robinson-Berry now.
Doctor. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And I personally have been tracking your professional career throughout my life. I know specifically you were mentioned as one of the named most powerful corporate leaders of America. Specifically, you mentioned you're the highest ranking African-American woman of a program manager for a multi-billion dollar corporation. So you've achieved and amassed so much in your career.